Yeah, so I don't think this particular video has any sound, and it's actually pretty short. It's a flyby by NASA's current Juno spacecraft orbiting the planet Jupiter. And what's really interesting is it's the cameras on this mission are not the primary instruments of science. They actually use a lot of RF radio type wave detectors studying the interior of Jupiter. But it's kind of last minute add-on camera called JunoCam makes these pictures when it makes the very close flybys of the planet. And they're just gorgeous what Jupiter looks like. So I thought I would include that as a kind of starting off little video for today's March 17th San Diego Astronomy Association members meeting. I want to thank you all for coming. I am your host, Steve Holman, Vice President, and the man behind the curtain with all the technology controls there is our president, Dave Wood. And so I always have to thank him for helping things go smoothly on the technology side. Because as Dave, thank you, Dave. as he mentioned, this is kind of our anniversary. Many people had to adapt to COVID, our organization did too. And that what came out of that was a basic Zoom presence. So now we have Zoom and other online media that we engage the public with. So if you will move on to the next slide. Okay. So first I want to say that we have a great website, SDAA.org. If you go to Google, type in SDAA.org, we're the first thing that comes up as the San Diego Astronomy Association. And we also have a Facebook account, a Twitter account, a YouTube, Instagram account. And if you go and follow those accounts, you will get, as another way that you get announcements of the different meetings that we hold, including this monthly meeting. In addition to that, Dave, if you will put the link to the into the chat on your Zoom meeting, there's a chat function, and we're going to put up the link so you can find for our members. We have a scope loaner program, so the club maintains a number of scopes that we loan out for a few months at a time to our members so that they can try different things, or if they're new to the organization, they can try out scopes that, you know, because they're trying to figure out what they might want to purchase. So there's the link. You can just copy that address and put it into the address window on your browser, take you right to that page on our website. Also, in addition to that, we have a monthly newsletter, and this month's March issue of our newsletter has all kinds of interesting astronomy content, including a great article on taking the dog stars for a springtime walk, Cirrus and Procyon. So I encourage you, and Dave, if you'll put the link to that up, all this content is on our website. So if you enjoy kind of navigating around, you can do that on our website. Or you can just copy the link out of the chat. That'll take you directly to this month's issue of the newsletter. So with that, if you can take us to the next slide. We also maintain a YouTube channel where we post not only our monthly meetings, but our outreach events and a number of other things that we do. And we currently have 403 subscribers and set over 73,000 views on our YouTube channel. And right there in the chat is the link that'll take you directly to our YouTube channel, or you can go on YouTube and type into their search box, San Diego Astronomy Association, and it will take you to our channel, and you can subscribe, and you hit the bell icon, it will notify you of whenever we post another video. The feature video that I want to point you towards right this month is the Caldwell objects in the winter sky. So there's a great video that you can watch that talks about interesting content about the Caldwell objects. So one of the groups, like Messier objects, and or the many other catalogs that are available. So that's an exciting thing. And so now, if you will take us to the next. So our subscribers just went up, apparently. Okay, so this really cool, but it's got sound, so I will just be quiet. Okay, so I just kind of recap what you just saw there. So marching along the bottom of that little video was actually kind of a little cartoon showing the stages of as the Perseverance rover deploys its parachute, drops its heat shield. And when the rover is then lowered from its what's called the sky crane, the upper part of it, what you're seeing through most of the video is there's a camera mounted on the bottom of the rover, and at the very beginning you're actually looking into the back of the heat shield, and then you see the heat shield drop away and you see it descend towards Mars. And then when you get at near the very end of the video, you see there are two other videos on the left side that appear, one of which is a video of the top of the rover looking up at the sky crane as they separate, and the other video is the sky crane looking down at the top of the rover as it separates. So you get kind of there are like three different views going on of the whole process by which the Perseverance rover autonomously landed on Mars, because the distance time is too long for messages from Earth. It essentially has to conduct its entire landing by itself, including as it's coming down. Well, with the sky crane, it actually is looking at the ground, it's matching up pictures, high resolution pictures that are stored in its memory banks to know where it is. And it actually uses its engines, not just to slow it down, but to guide it to the specific location that it wants to land in. So it's really an impressive, complicated procedure, first time ever. And one of our previous speakers, Dr. Baggett from Caltech, was very concerned, worried that something would go wrong, and he was ecstatic when it actually went correct. So if you can now take us to the next slide, which is a panorama that was built. Once Perseverance landed, it proceeded to set its cameras about taking pictures of a panorama around the spacecraft, so of the rover. There's the wheels, as you can see, looking out onto the surface of Mars. So that was a cool thing. And then on our next slide, we could play that again. So our organization has many semi-professional amateurs. So I hit them periodically for providing me some of their pictures so that I can show you some of the really beautiful astronomy pictures that are collected by our members. They're both technically difficult because they and aesthetically beautiful at the same time, and you can appreciate them for either of those facts. This particular one, done of Messier's 65 and 66, and NGC catalog 3628-3, so the three galaxies you see near the center of the image, was done by one of our members, Alan Ruckel. This is actually a very short picture, only 50-second exposure, and it was taken out at our dark site, Terra del Sol, which is out the 8 freeway about halfway to Arizona. So that's about how far you have to go out of San Diego to get really dark skies. So I thought that was very fascinating and beautiful, and I wanted to give an example of what you can do. I present a lot of pictures where we will take 20 hours of narrowband imagery, most commonly in like the Hubble palette or something like that. But this one I liked because it was actually a very short exposure. It was about a minute of exposure time, giving you the feel that you can, sometimes you can take interesting, useful pictures without having to do it for, you know, many hours of scope time. So, and that is actually kind of the short front end I have before, and now I would like to.